This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. I have another exciting episode for you. I bought a farm. Just kidding. I wish I did. One of these days I'll have a farm and have an orchard like this. But what we're going to do today is actually we're going to visit an orchard that has over 150 varieties, and many of which are rare and unknown varieties of fruit trees growing. This is standard property, and there's a lower orchard, an upper orchard, a standard garden, plus a greenhouse where many tropical trees are being grown. This is the orchard of Phil, and he's actually the past president of the California Rare Fruit Growers Redwood Empire. You know, if you are into fruit trees and growing fruits and live in California, or even if you're not, you want to check out the website crfg.org to learn more about the California Rare Fruit Growers. And now it's their mission to spread the word about fresh fruits and all the different unique and rare varieties that can be grown that are not often available today in commerce. So anyways, I'm really excited to show you guys the upper orchard, the lower orchard, and his greenhouse where he has some really cool trees growing. So let's check it out. Now we're in the regular garden, you know, and we're looking at some of the tomatoes, and they got tomatoes and melons and cucumbers and beans. And I want to remind you guys that yes, tomatoes, while considered a vegetable by many, they are a fruit because they contain seeds, as well as things like melons and cucumbers are all fruits. And there's a lot of things growing in this garden. But, and while this is interesting, we're not talking about stuff or vegetable type plants or even tomatoes. We're gonna talk about some of the cool stuff that's in the greenhouse behind us. So let's go inside this greenhouse. And actually first, let's look at the construction, because the construction of this greenhouse, definitely really cool. You can see here they're using some standard concrete blocks for the bottom. And at one time, I'm sure this was level. And then what they got is these big sliding glass windows, basically like, you know, sliders that you'd have on your house. And this whole greenhouse thing is constructed out of these sliding glass windows that, you know, many times people put double pane or now triple panes on, and the single panes come off, and then they go to places like Recycle Town here, actually probably down the hill, which maybe these were sourced at. And you could just get these for free or cheap, and you could build a greenhouse out of them. In addition, the tops here, they're definitely really cool. I don't know where these are sourced from, but these look like 70s style like skylights from maybe some big commercial building or something. But these were just put in up top, and with the sides on, it's actually nice and warm in here. Another cool feature of this, besides these cool fruit posters, which shows a lot of different tropical fruits. Actually, this fruit poster is showing some of the tropical fruit from Hawaii. And then here's a fig poster, and look at all the varieties of figs. There's 126 varieties of figs shown in this poster. How many of those have you guys eaten? Underneath here is actually the hot tub, and this is actually an excellent thing to have in your greenhouse, believe it or not. The water acts as a heat sink to absorb the heat, and it lets it out at night. Also in the winter months, you could kind of hop in your hot tub and enjoy all the plants in the background. This is the moment you guys have all been waiting for, and the moment I've been waiting for too, to see what's actually growing here in Northern California, about 1 hour north of San Francisco, in this protected greenhouse. And you know, there's many things happening. We got a nice potting table where things get potted up, and there's some plants in containers. And that's an excellent thing you can do. You can grow plants in containers. Here's some white sapote, some cherimoya, bacon avocado. And I would always remind you guys that, you know, growing in containers is a viable option, especially if you're renting your place. You could put up a temporary structure to keep something warm, and maybe you're gonna move later, or maybe it's getting too cold outside even under your temporary structure. If you don't live maybe in a northern climate, you could bring it actually inside. So you can grow some of these tropicals inside in the wintertime, but be aware that they might not fruit because, you know, some of these plants do need high light or a lot of light to actually produce the fruit for you. Now let's take a look at some of the things growing in the ground. The first thing we're gonna look at is the Rakoto pepper. And I'm growing a Rakoto, or also closely related to the Manzano peppers in my greenhouse also. And they fruit year round here in the climate. And you can see here, see, these are some of the ones that actually haven't been harvested. They're actually drying on the plant. And you can see there's plenty of green ones that are gonna probably ripen up through the winter time. And there's even still flowers. So yes, this would be an excellent crop to grow in a greenhouse. Now this, based on my research and my opinion at this time, is probably one of the most cold hardy varieties of peppers you can grow, but they're also very hot. And actually I have a really good episode, me eating
some manzano peppers in my greenhouse, and the first bite wasn't hot, then the second one was. Oh, and I was paying for it.
Next, we're gonna look at this guy. Actually, this is called the black sapote. The black sapote is related more to a persimmon than a sapote. And you can see here some of the smaller-ish fruit on here. Now, they get much larger, much like the size of a regular persimmon.
You know, once again, I wanna talk about, you know, growing things for fun. Like, you know, fruit is literally a hobby here. So he's experimenting with many different things, or growing things for actually eating and for actually making a large quantity of food. Many of the things that I personally grow, while I do grow a few for fun, I'm more into, you know, growing food for eating and having a good sustainable source of food, and also having new varieties that you literally can't buy. So I want to remind you guys that not everything seen in the greenhouse, if you tried to grow where you live, may do well, and it may not actually yield that much at all either. So then you might want to consider growing some regular fruit trees that are going to produce a lot more fruit for you to eat.
Next, we're going to look at this guy. This is Babaco, and this might be the very tree that my trees are cut from. Babaco, you just literally cut it off, and then it'll root on its own once you cut off a section. And here's some of these fruits. These are huge, gigantic fruits. Tons of them on there. This thing is loaded up. But I want you guys to look at this trunk. I mean, this trunk is literally like a foot and a half in diameter. Completely insane. This thing's rooted into the ground. I have found that the Babaco doesn't like standing water, especially in the wintertime. It will actually succumb to root rot quite easily. But these roots, I mean, these guys are massive, man. And these guys definitely will need to be grown in a greenhouse. They don't like it when it gets too cold. And actually, they don't like it when it's too sweltering hot either. But if you do, you'll be rewarded with all these fruits. And be sure to check my video on the Babaco fruit, where I actually taste one for you guys. They have an interesting flavor. You'd think they'd be sweet like a papaya, but they're not all that sweet. Man, we're passing up so many other cool trees. Here's one right here. This is actually called the carambola, also known as star fruit. This guy looks amazing, although I don't know if some of these fruits are producing or not. Back over this way, we have a chirimoya tree, and chirimoyas, and chirimoyas probably do pretty good. I think this guy's actually flowering currently, and maybe we'll put on some fruit. But once again, the climate optimally should be a little bit warmer for chirimoya, so that's probably more of an experiment. And these guys here are definitely experiments. This is actually a long on, straight up a tropical. Looks like it's been having some challenges staying alive. And over here, the cousin of the long on, lychee. And this guy is doing a little bit better, but still looking like it's having some struggles. Of course, this guy right here, I grew this guy out of the greenhouse. In the greenhouse, it should probably be doing pretty well. It's actually called the pepino melon, and that's an interesting fruit, although I don't know if I'd waste some greenhouse space on it. Maybe if my greenhouse is this big, I would. Over here, we have a cardamom, which is the spice here, and this is a nice tropical-looking plant. Looks like it's doing quite well in this environment. In addition, we got a raised bed made out of solid metal here. And they got a caper bush. So yes, those little pickled capers. You can grow your own caper bush and pickle your own capers. Of course, also in the greenhouse, always room for another tomato plant. And these tomatoes look nice, deep, and rich red. Over on this side is a passion fruit. And here's some passion fruits growing and falling. This guy right here. And this may be the same variety of passion fruit that I'm growing, because actually my starter plants were purchased from Phil. Another fruit tree that's growing here in the greenhouse is called the che. And these guys are amazing. I had one of these before, and they're really good fruit. These guys probably don't do well in commerce because they don't actually ship well at all. But they do freeze pretty good if you have some ripe che you want to eat for later. Next is one of my favorite trees, and it's currently in its flowering stage. And actually, here's some unopened flowers. And this smells like hot buttered popcorn, is what my old gardener used to say, because I had a nice tamarillo tree out of my greenhouse, and it lasted about 2 years next to the side of my house, but it really didn't make it. It doesn't like the cold at all. But one of the coolest things is that while I was sitting inside looking out my window, I'd see all these little fruits on there, and there's no fruits on here, but they look like little Christmas tree ornaments hanging in the wintertime, because the tree would lose all its leaves, but the fruit would still be hanging on there.
But this is Tamarillo, nice and tall, amazing, will do amazingly inside the greenhouse, and I'm sure this thing fruits a lot. I have currently am growing one myself in my greenhouse, but it's being attacked by aphids currently, which is not fun. Over in this area, we got some banana plants. Now, these aren't banana trees, these are banana plants. Bananas are an herbaceous plant. In addition, we got a lot of dragon fruits, all different kinds of varieties, probably at least 10 varieties of dragon fruits growing here. And they're using this lighter thing to train them up and grow up. In general, they use old tree stumps and trees that are no longer alive to grow the dragon fruit up it if they're being grown outside. Here's yet another tropical tree that is growing inside because of the greenhouse. It's actually called the guava tree. And this is actually called a white guava. And here's some fruits on here. Not quite ripe yet, and actually there's a bunch, and this tree looks like it's loving the inside. Now, the only way to eat guava, in my opinion, is right off the tree. If you go to buy guava, especially imported guava, many times I have seen that they are now being irradiated, which is quite sad. And, you know, most guavas are picked far too early to have the full flavor and the full nutrition in them. Because if they were picked when they're ripe, they'd literally go bad before they got to market. So grow your own guavas or go to somewhere tropical like Hawaii and pick guavas fresh off the tree for highest nutrition and the best taste. Over here is another cool plant that I've also tried to grow in my unheated greenhouse and it hasn't been too successful. This is actually called the Suriname cherry. These guys may be hardy to maybe 28 or so, but this guy looks pretty small. But although it is hardy to 28 degrees or thereabouts, I've never had any success with it. But it looks like it's growing pretty well here, and maybe in future years it'll actually fruit. The last tree that we're going to cover in the greenhouse here is actually a white sapote. And actually I've seen a huge and gigantic white sapote trees actually planted in the ground in Fremont. But between Fremont and here is probably an hour and a half, and because of the bay influences in Fremont, it stays warmer, especially in the wintertime, and that's what this plant doesn't like. It doesn't like to get too cold. I have a white sapote in a container and I'm gonna move it into my greenhouse and hopefully on my unheated greenhouse in the winter, it'll survive and actually start to produce fruit for me, even in a small container. But I'll probably get one or two. Before we leave the greenhouse, I wanna talk about this last plant that's in a container, just randomly. It's actually a carob tree. And this guy right here is a carob tree. Now, when you think of carob, do you think of like, you know, those like carob coated nuts from the health food store in the bulk bins that your parents made you eat when you were a kid and they tasted horrible, but they're supposed to be healthy for you? Well, I don't know if those things are healthy, but I can tell you that I've had fresh carob pods off the tree. It's one of my favorite delicacies. Literally, they're like little bean pods. Don't bite the seeds because you will break your teeth, but they have an amazing flavor. Kind of tastes a little bit chocolatey if you get a good one. They're actually quite sweet and kind of like bread. Actually, they're called St. John's bread. If you get a good one that's nice and ripe off the tree, you'll even get a little like carob syrup inside that's naturally occurring. That stuff's totally amazing. So I definitely encourage you guys to eat some fresh carob pods. They are slow growers. I do have one in a container and they're taking a while. Maybe I'll put them in the greenhouse. And they don't like to get too cold either. They're a Mediterranean type crop. But I definitely encourage you guys to eat carob instead of cacao or chocolate, which in my opinion is not quite as healthy. Carob is much higher in fiber than cacao, and cacao or chocolate will also kill your animals if you feed it to them. Now we're gonna walk up into the upper orchard, and in this orchard there's about maybe 60 trees. They're all different kinds. Here's actually an apple here. And we're gonna look at some of the unique varieties. There's over 60 trees and they're planted about 10 feet apart. Many of them, as you can see, are actually kept small by pruning. They also may be on dwarf rootstock. So if you have a small amount of space and you want to fit in a lot, you definitely want to grow in a dwarf rootstock so the trees don't get too big. Also, this way, if you keep them small, guess what? You don't need a ladder to harvest them either. Just a few of the trees in this upper orchard besides the pears and the apples are figs. So you can see this is like your standard fig with a standard like fig leaf that looks like this. And up over here was a cool tree. I was kind of thinking, man, what is this tree? You can see the leaf, right? Looks really cool. The a little bit furry or fuzzy on the stems of the plants. And I was like, man, what kind of tropical tree is this? And check it out. It's yet another fig tree. Just the leaves are just a little bit different shape than I've never seen before. So
So trees come in all shapes and sizes. Actually, next, let's take a look at another cool tree that many of you guys may not have seen before either. When I find a new tree, and especially one that's an evergreen here in Northern California, this is called the umbu tree. It's from Argentina, and it actually grows on the edge of the rainforest, between the rainforest and the grasslands. And it produces these little red berries that are edible. But this tree has been here for about, I don't know, 6-7 years now, hasn't produced fruit yet. That's because it gets a little bit too cold here in the winter time, and the first year was like yay big, lost all its greens, but it came back and keeps coming back every year, and every year it just grows a little bit more in the nice summertime, but then doesn't make it too good in the winter. Because it is so large now, you know, some of the outside leaves and some of the tops may get frost damage, but the inside is gonna stay nice and healthy. So maybe in future years it'll start producing some fruit, and maybe if I'm lucky I'll even get to taste it. Phil will start actually doing some cuttings off these to see if this can be cutted and rooted so that this tree can be made available to more people. Next we're going to talk about this fruit tree, and this fruit tree right here is called the quince tree. And so this is a quince fruit, and the quince fruit, they're actually related to the apple, and these guys are generally very astringent and need to be cooked before eating them. Or actually what you could do is if you let them totally ripen up and what's called blet, and then they're totally like looking like they're going bad, then you could finally eat them raw without cooking. But generally these guys are actually very fragrant, so they have actually really nice aroma. I'd actually like to have a quince perfume. Now we're gonna talk about apple trees. Apples are probably the dominant kind of tree planted here. There's many different varieties of apples planted. And you know, there's a lot more varieties than maybe the half dozen of varieties of apples that you can buy at your supermarket. So a lot of the apples that we have on the supermarket shelves are basically, they store well, they remain firm, but they may not have actually the best flavor, the best taste, or other attributes. Yeah, here behind me is one of the apple trees. And you can see this one's actually a multi-grafted tree. It's growing up, and they hack off one branch right here, and they literally paste on another one called grafting. And this branch has red Gravenstein apples growing out of it, a popular variety here in Sonoma County. I think another part of the tree has a pink pearl variety apples. So let me go ahead and show you guys a pink pearl. Let's see. The ripest place to find a fruit, it's always on the ground. So here's a pink pearl. Should be pretty ripe. And you can see the yellowish pink tinge. But when I bite into it, this is where it looks really cool. Mmm, look at that. This one's totally pink on the inside. This one has an amazing flavor. This is not necessarily a sweet apple, a little bit tart, but the flavor is absolutely amazing. This is probably one of my favorite apples on earth, and I wish more people would be able to experience this apple. But unfortunately, these guys actually get soft and kind of, they don't ship well or store well, so unless you're buying it directly from a farmer's market, from the farmer, or growing them yourself, you're not gonna be able to get things like pink pearls and other heirloom fruits. So I always want to encourage you guys to at least plant a few fruit trees on your property if you have the space. Next, I want to let you guys know that there is always a way to grow a fruit tree, or in this case, blueberry bushes. You can see here, they definitely have some deer in this area. This is a deer cage, and this is made out of the standard EMT electrical conduit. They made basically a box. It's nice and welded, pretty strong. And they put chicken wire around it so that the plants inside, which is actually the blueberries, and actually they're fruiting right now, can grow without being damaged by the deer. And when you want to get in, this thing is actually quite light. You can just actually pick it up and harvest some delicious blueberries. And that's how you can protect your fruit trees and even your vegetables. You could put this over the raised bed very simply, very easily, from deer and other critters. Just keep them out. Besides trees, there's also shrubs and vines, and here's just one of them, your standard raspberry. And these are just happen to be just nice, delicious red raspberries. Nothing special going on here, but let's take a look a couple plants down and show you some cool raspberries they're growing. Okay, over here we got some yellow raspberries. So yellow raspberries, they can fake out the birds, because to birds, these might not look ripe. But to you and I, I actually like them, and they taste better to me than the red ones. Plus, they're quite unique. So I always encourage you guys to eat a wide variety of colors, and grow a wide variety of colors of fruits and vegetables as well. While this may look like a drying rack for clothes, this is actually a super gigantic trellis for kiwis. So you can see the kiwis wrapping around this trellis here, and the goal is to get the kiwis up to the top and just wrap around and fill this whole structure. And there's a few kiwis hanging up here on the plant here. But remember, if you're gonna grow kiwis, you definitely need to have a male to pollinate the females, very important. Now we're in the lower orchard, and the lower orchard's done just a little bit differently than the upper orchard. As I said before, the upper orchard, the spacing was maybe 10 feet, and in the lower orchard, sometimes the spacing is as close as 6 feet together. So that's actually planting things really close. Very important, if you plant things really close, you wanna keep them short, and so that you could harvest them really easy so that they don't overgrow the amount of space that you give them. But even in a small amount of space, they have a lot of fruit trees and a lot of different varieties growing. Here's a loquat tree, and this one's actually no taller than 6 feet tall. Nice and bushy, easy to harvest. One of my favorite fruits because it does keep its leaves evergreen. It keeps its leaves green year round. Like that a lot. Also, the fruits are quite delicious, and the loquat is another one that you actually can't often buy because the fruits are highly perishable. Moving up along over here, this is another amazing fruit right here. These are called actually variegated figs. And check out the little candy striping on that. Definitely good. And let me tell you, these guys taste as good as they look. Here's just two apple trees, and literally, I mean, they're planted within an arm's length of each other, maybe like 5 feet apart. But look, they're both producing pretty well. So I want to point out this variety of apple here. This is actually called the golden russet apple. So this is a russeted apple, much like the russet potato. But these are russeted apples. Now, unfortunately, you don't often see russeted apples in the stores anymore because they've kind of gone out of popularity. But a good heirloom apple to grow, and especially if you're growing, you know, apples, you could have so many different kinds. And I mean, look, this tree is just loaded up with fruit. One of the things I want to point out is if your branches do get too heavy, you want to just get some pieces of stick, you know, and put a little curve in the top like this. And then you're just going to support the branch with it. Otherwise, this branch would be so heavy it would maybe break. So they have a lot of different sticks hanging out in the orchard, propping up branches that are full of delicious fruit. Oh, another thing really quick I want to show you guys is this right here. Every different tree and every branch that has a different variety has a tag on it. So this is in metal, and it's basically just etched out with a carver. So this is not ever gonna deteriorate, or you're never gonna forget the variety. And it says golden russet apple. And I think this also tells the kind of rootstock, and that's just basically wrapped around this. And you could easily use something like gutter flashing to you know, use this. Old aluminum cans also work fairly well so that you can label your fruit trees because they're gonna be around for a while. And one day you might not remember all the varieties you planted. Now we're looking at yet another tree that's planted about 6 feet away from all the others. And you can see it's just literally loaded up with apples. And this thing is no taller than 5-6 feet tall at the most. And literally there's 100 apples on here. So literally by just dedicating a little bit of space in your yard, you can grow an apple tree and you can eat an apple a day to keep the doctor away. Now we're looking at one of the many pear trees. Besides having a lot of apples, there's also many varieties of pears. This climate here is really good for growing things like apples and pears. And this happens to be my favorite variety of pear. Yes, this is the size of the fruit. You can see they get about this big. And these guys are actually called seckle pears. If you've never had these guys, I highly encourage you guys to grow some seckles or actually get them ripe from a farmer's market, because oftentimes when they're sold in trade, they're just not quite ripe and you're not getting the full flavor. But these guys, oh my God. This is probably one of the sweetest pears on earth. I love them so much. Besides the apples and the pears, there's also many stone fruit trees, and one of which is right behind me. Looks like pretty much they're almost all out of season, but there's one left, and this is it right here. This is actually called an Italian prune, and this is where they get the prunes from. You know, they dry these guys, and that's how you got prunes. Basically, prunes you would think of as a dried plum, but this is a special variety that they actually use to make the prunes. But yes, it is technically a plum. But besides being good for drying, these are good for eating out of hand. Mmm, delicious. All right, so first I wanna say my shirt says it all. It says peace, love, and seasonal fruit. I love my fruit, and I'm so glad that Phil was able to let me film here and show his amazing collections and all the different varieties of fruit trees he's growing. The one message I want you guys to take home from this video today is that I want to encourage you guys to grow heirloom and grow wide varieties of fruits, many more varieties that can be found in your grocery store. There's many varieties of fruit trees available, and I hope in the future to have more episodes on fruits and also vegetables of unique and rare varieties that you can grow yourself at home. So hopefully this has motivated you to start growing some fruit trees today, even in a container. Yes, you can do it. So once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing.